What is up, engine heads? Today we won't be talking about engines. Instead, we'll be talking about a very hard-working piece of equipment that transfers power and torque from your engine to your transmission and from there to the rest of your drivetrain. Of course, I'm talking about the clutch, and if you remove a used one from a car, it's gonna make your hands really dirty. And we'll be talking about OEM stock type clutches and then comparing them with performance clutches. We'll also be talking about different clutch materials, different clutch disc shapes. We'll also cover pressure plates and multi-plate clutches. And of course, we will be talking about different benefits and drawbacks of all of these different clutch types. So sit back, relax, and together, let's dive deep into the clutch. So the main task of the clutch is to transfer power and torque from your engine to your transmission. The clutch is directly connected to the input shaft of your transmission, but it grabs onto the flywheel of your engine using friction. This is where the name clutch comes from the verb to clutch, to firmly, strongly grab onto something. So your clutch clutches the flywheel of your engine when you release the clutch pedal and engage the clutch. This is when the clutch establishes a strong friction-based connection with the flywheel. Constantly making and breaking that friction-based connection is the task of the pressure plate. The pressure plate has two main parts, the diaphragm spring, which is this thing, and the pressure plate itself. The pressure plate is the part that presses against the clutch and clamps it against the flywheel. When you're pressing in the clutch pedal, you're actually pressing in the middle part of the diaphragm spring. When this part gets pressed in, the outer part, the pressure plate, gets pressed out and it relieves pressure from the clutch. And then as you let go of the clutch pedal, the middle part comes back up and the outer part, the pressure plate, comes back down onto the clutch and firmly squeezes it against the flywheel. The stronger, the heavier the diaphragm spring, the more clamping force will be exerted onto the clutch, pushing it harder against the flywheel. Okay, so that's in simple terms how a clutch works. Now the question is, why would you want to upgrade it? Well, if you're daily driving a stock unmodified car and if you plan to keep it that way, then you really shouldn't upgrade your clutch. There's no good incentive to do it. The stock OEM clutch is well designed for the engine. It's going to provide a lot of worry-free, easy and comfortable operation in many different settings. However, if you decide to modify your engine and significantly increase its power and torque output, then you are interested in upgrading your clutch. Because when you increase the power and especially the torque output of your engine, then your engine will eventually overpower the clutch. The clutch won't have enough friction to keep grabbing onto the flywheel, and the pressure plate won't generate enough clamping force to keep the clutch on the flywheel, and the result is that your clutch is going to start slipping. A slipping clutch means that the clutch isn't doing its job. Your engine's power is being wasted and it's not being transferred onto the wheels. Also, an engine that's stronger than the clutch is going to drastically shorten the lifespan of your clutch. And this is why, to avoid this kind of scenario, significant power and torque upgrades of your engine go hand in hand with clutch upgrades. Another scenario where you might want to consider upgrading your clutch even without significantly modifying your engine is if you're significantly changing the intended application of your vehicle. For example, if you're switching from daily driving to doing a lot of track driving or autocross or even drifting, then you might want to consider upgrading your clutch, because these applications are going to expose your clutch to a lot more abuse, a lot harder use, a lot higher temperatures, all of which may call for a clutch upgrade. Now we're going to compare different clutch disc materials. We're going to compare three different types of materials: organic, Kevlar, and metal. We're starting with the basic organic clutch discs. Now, organic clutch disc materials are the OEM standard, and they have been the OEM standard for decades. As the name suggests, the base material is organic, usually a phenolic resin or compounded rubber together with cellulose as an organic friction material. This mix of materials is relatively weak and it is susceptible to bursting or shearing apart under loads. This is why mineral wool and or fiberglass is usually added into the mix. Mineral wool and or fiberglass increase the burst strength of the disc and they also help with temperature resistance. A step up from the most basic organic clutches, which are made by molding, are heavy-duty organic clutches which have metallic fibers or metallic wire woven into the clutch disc. This further increases burst strength, it helps with temperature resistance, and it also ensures that the clutch can generate more grip or more friction. You can find clutches like this on medium and high-powered vehicles, and they do have a longer expected lifespan and can handle more abuse compared to the most basic molded clutches. The only downside is their higher price. When they're well made, organic clutches have many advantages, which explains why they're the OEM material of choice. They offer very smooth and gradual engagement, which means that they're comfortable and easy to use for daily driving and stop and go traffic. They offer adequate friction over a very broad range of temperatures, and they also have minimal or no break-in period. A decent organic clutch is going to last many, many miles, and it can even handle some abuse and racing use in the hands of a capable and careful driver. So organic clutches are great, right? What more could you ask for? For one thing, more friction. Organic clutches have a relatively low coefficient of friction, which means that they're not very grabby, they aren't very abrasive, and therefore they offer smooth engagement. A relatively low coefficient of friction is one of the main reasons why organic clutches offer such smooth and gradual engagement. In reality, they actually slip a bit before they fully connect with the flywheel, and this is why they're so easy to operate, easy to feather when you're driving around town. But this low coefficient of friction is also why they can't keep up with major engine upgrades that increase engine power and torque. Something else that organic clutches are lacking in is resistance to abuse, hard usage, and high temperatures. Although organic clutches will take a bit of abuse, repeated abuse will quickly end the life of any organic clutch. At sufficiently high temperatures, the organic materials will start to melt and they will form a glazed surface on the clutch disc, and then the clutch disc will start slipping and you will need to replace your organic clutch. So let's step things up by borrowing something from bulletproof vests. Kevlar. When in tension, Kevlar is around 5 times stronger than your typical steel alloy. This is how it stops bullets after all. But in addition to stopping bullets, it can dramatically improve the performance and the lifespan of your clutch under hard usage. A Kevlar clutch disc can resist an incredible amount of very hard usage of very hard and abrupt engagements and disengagements, for example, track driving or autocross or whatever. On the other hand, Kevlar clutch discs absolutely hate stop and go traffic. They hate slow and smooth gradual engagements that are necessary in public traffic conditions. Using the Kevlar clutch like this, repeated slow engagements can actually glaze the surface of the Kevlar clutch disc, causing it to slip. In some cases, if you use it very hard after a lot of stop and go driving, you can remove the glazing from the Kevlar clutch and restore most of its properties. But in many other cases, it can't actually be saved after it's been glazed and it needs to be replaced. Kevlar clutches can resist higher temperatures and have better burst strength than most organics, and they have amazing wear resistance when they're used the way they're intended. The additional benefit is that they can offer the same smooth and gradual engagement as organics. They can do this because just like organic clutches, they have a relatively low coefficient of friction. In other words, they're not very abrasive, so they do not grab very hard onto the clutch. This means that they need a very strong, very stiff, hard pressure plate that's going to force the Kevlar clutch to grab against the flywheel. A stronger, harder pressure plate typically means that you need more effort from your foot to work the clutch. So Kevlar clutches are great for repeated hard usage, for example, driving on the track, but they're not such a good idea in city driving conditions. Well, that's not necessarily the case, because there is a way to improve the performance of Kevlar clutches in daily driving conditions, and we can do this by segmenting the clutch disc. This has two benefits. First of all, it helps heat dissipation, which means that a segmented clutch disc won't start to overheat and melt and glaze during repeated gradual takeoffs as soon as a full-faced clutch disc would. The other benefits of a reduced surface area is that we increase the pressure on that area, which means that we can relieve some pressure requirements from the pressure plate. The only downside is that less surface area does somewhat shorten the lifespan of a segmented Kevlar clutch disc. All that being said, a segmented Kevlar clutch disc is going to be a better all-rounder than a full-faced one. The other downside of Kevlar clutches is that they usually require very long braking periods before they feel right. Depending on the clutch, this can be anywhere between 300 to 1,000 miles. So Kevlar clutches are a step up from organic clutches. They can take more hard usage, but they really aren't aggressive. They do have a relatively low coefficient of friction, which means that they aren't suitable for holding down truly high amounts of power and torque. They aren't as grabby or as abrasive as they need to be to do that. So let's say you want to hold down higher amounts of power and torque. You want something that's aggressive and powerful. What kind of material should you use? Well, if you recall, we added metallic wire to our organic clutches to make them suitable for higher amounts of torque. But let's say that instead of using just little bitty strands of metallic wire, we make the whole thing out of metal. And that's exactly what this is. This is an all-metal clutch. This particular one is from MRP, Manor Racing Products in New Zealand, and it's going into my turbo for a FE engine build. By the way, if you need serious high-performance, high-quality clutch kits for 4A and many other engine platforms, definitely check out the clutch kits from MRP. There's a bunch of links down below. Clutches like this are also sometimes called ceramic clutches. Ironically, they contain very little or no ceramic in them at all. Instead, usually the base metal is copper or bronze or a mix of both, and then iron, steel, silicon, graphite, or a bit of ceramics or any mix thereof is added into the mix to make the discs even more abrasive to increase the friction properties of these discs. Now, a more correct name for these clutch discs would be centered metal discs, because they're made using the sintering process, whereby a mold is filled with powdered metals, and then these metals are fused into a single unit using very high heat and pressure. Copper and many other metals are excellent heat conductors, which means that sintered metal discs can tolerate really high temperatures. It's very hard to overheat them, which means that you can really let loose on the track. Now, they have a very high coefficient of friction, unlike organic or Kevlar clutch discs, and a very high coefficient of friction means that they can hold high power and high torque without the need of a very strong, very tough pressure plate. But there is a downside to this, because they have a very high coefficient of friction. Sintered metal discs do not ever slip. They do not gradually grab onto the flywheel. Instead, they grab onto the flywheel very suddenly and very strongly, sometimes with chattering or shuddering sounds and sensations accompanying engagement and disengagement. This means that smooth and gradual takeoff with a sintered metal clutch is often pretty difficult. It means that although they can tolerate driving around town, they will likely tire out the driver pretty quickly. So some people claim they can tolerate them for daily driving, while others can't. Fact is that because they're very abrasive, they have a very high coefficient of friction, sintered metal discs won't be as gentle to your flywheel as Kevlar or organic clutch discs would. A drawback of sintered metal clutches is that overall they do have a shorter lifespan when compared to Kevlar or organic clutches, but the flip side is that in high abuse, hard use, and high temperature scenarios, a sintered metal clutch is going to outlast and outperform both organic and Kevlar clutches. But let's say that even a sintered metal clutch isn't enough for you. You need to hold down 1000 horsepower and God knows how much torque. What kind of clutch material should you use in that scenario? Well, in that case, you need sintered iron. You can think of sintered iron discs as everything a regular copper or bronze-based sintered metal clutch is, but on steroids. A sintered iron disc has an even higher coefficient of friction. It's even more abrasive, which means that it can hold absolutely obscene amounts of power without ever slipping. But because it's so abrasive, it's going to destroy conventional flywheels. Also, smooth engagement with a sintered iron disc is next to impossible, which means that using them on the street is very, very difficult, if not impossible. Many people describe sintered iron discs as being a switch. They're either on or off, but they are great for holding obscene amounts of power without ever slipping, and they can tolerate incredible temperatures. It's next to impossible to overheat and glaze a sintered iron disc, which means that they're perfect for extreme all-out racing applications. So here we have a little table that lists the general properties of different clutch materials. As you can see, the overall trend is to sacrifice smoothness, gradual engagement, and usage comfort in the interest of being able to hold down more power and torque. When it comes to a clutch's ability to hold down power and torque, we have three main variables. These are the surface area of the clutch disc, the clamping force exerted on the clutch disc, and the abrasiveness or the coefficient of friction or the grabbiness, if you will, of the clutch disc material. When it comes to Kevlar clutch discs, as you can see, we increase the clamping force to be able to hold down more power and torque. When it comes to segmented Kevlar clutch discs, we also reduce the surface area to help heat dissipation and to increase the pressure on that surface area. When it comes to all metal clutch discs, we increase the abrasiveness to be able to hold down more power, but we also reduce the surface area. When it comes to reducing surface area on sintered metal clutch discs, there's an additional reason to this other than heat dissipation and increasing the pressure. The additional reason is that metal as a clutch disc material is very heavy. A full-faced sintered metal clutch disc would actually be noticeably heavier than an organic OEM clutch disc, which would result in a very high moment of inertia for such a clutch disc. And this is of course undesirable, because with a high moment of inertia, the engine needs more work to accelerate the clutch disc up to speed, and this would noticeably hurt shifting times, which is definitely undesirable in performance applications. And this is why we have 6 or even 3 puck clutch discs available in the aftermarket. As you can see, they remove as much material as possible from the clutch disc in the interest of reducing the moment of inertia of the clutch disc as much as possible. Now, as you can see, the common thing in all of these situations is that we cannot increase the surface area of the clutch disc. We can only reduce it. We cannot increase it because we are limited by the size of the flywheel. A clutch disc cannot be larger than the flywheel, because then it wouldn't fit and it simply wouldn't work. So if we cannot increase the surface area of a single clutch disc, what can we do? Of course, we can use more than one clutch disc. And this is exactly what multi-plate clutch kits are. They usually use 2 or even more, sometimes 3 clutch discs instead of 1, to increase the surface area. Having more surface area to grab onto the flywheel means that we can hold down more power and torque without messing about too much with the clamping force or the abrasiveness variables. For example, an organic twin plate clutch kit is going to be able to hold down as much power and torque as an all metal 6-puck or even a 3-puck clutch would, all while offering similar comfort and smoothness as an OEM single plate clutch. Now, these twin plate and multi plate clutch kits aren't going to be cheap. They require custom flywheels, and in the past they used to be reserved for professional motorsport applications, but thanks to our modern reality of 1000 horsepower daily driven cars, they are now readily available in the aftermarket. If you need to hold down absolutely ridiculous amounts of power and torque, then you can get multi-plate clutch kits that use sintered metal or even sintered iron as the material for their individual discs. Now, these will be able to hold down more power and torque than any single disc could, but they will be very unfriendly towards daily driving and will be very uncomfortable to use on the street. You also might be thinking that having more than one clutch disc negatively impacts the moment of inertia, because after all, now the engine has to accelerate more than one clutch disc. Well, that's not actually the case, because multiple clutch discs have more than enough surface area at their disposal. They can reduce the size of each individual disc. By removing material from the outer part of the disc, you greatly reduce its moment of inertia. However, multiple clutch kits that have very small discs are very hard to use on the street. It's very easy to stall the engine with them, but of course the low moment of inertia does help performance. Now we're going to talk about these little springs right here and what they do. This is a sprung clutch disc, and these springs are used to absorb some of the shock of torque transfer from your engine onto your transmission and the rest of your drivetrain. When you suddenly release the clutch pedal, this is when your clutch is going to be abruptly connected to your flywheel. There will be some shock due to this rapid and sudden connection. And what these springs do is that they absorb much of this shock before it can reach your transmission and the rest of your drivetrain. This means that they make the clutch smoother and nicer to use in all conditions, but they also do help prevent transmission and drivetrain damage. As you can see, my MRP clutch is a high performance abrasive clutch that can handle a lot of power and torque, but it also has these little springs right here. This is because it's designed to also be tolerable and usable and not too harsh when it's used on the street. Now, there is a downside to these springs, and this is that they can increase shifting time somewhat, but more importantly, they can be a point of failure on any clutch. They can actually pop out of the hub in extreme situations. And what I really like about my MRP clutch disc is that, as you can see, the springs are very heavily encased in the hub. This is well engineered, and the probability of these springs popping out is pretty much zero. Something else that helps absorb away clutch harshness is this wafer that you can see when you turn the clutch on its edge. This is called a Marcel spring, or just a Marcel, and it's a very thin, wavy spring that helps absorb away chattering and shuddering sounds and sensations coming from the clutch. As the clutch begins to be engaged with the flywheel, this is when the Marcel spring is going to compress, and as it does so, it reduces harshness and, most importantly, minimizes or completely eliminates chattering and shuddering coming from the clutch. In general, when you see a clutch disc that has springs and a Marcel, you can be pretty sure that it's going to be relatively tolerable to use around town, despite of the clutch material. If you see a clutch disc that is completely rigid with zero springs in it, you can be sure that it is intended for all out racing applications. However, don't be confused, because sometimes you can see OEM organic stock clutch discs that do not have springs on them, but this simply tells you that the vehicle very likely has a dual mass flywheel, and the dual mass flywheel does all the shock absorption instead of the clutch. And there you have it. That's the one-on-one on different clutch features, types, and materials. I hope this video came in clutch, and I hope it helps you better understand your clutch and make a more educated choice if you decide to upgrade the clutch on your vehicle. As always, thanks a lot for watching, and I'll be seeing you soon with more fun and useful stuff on the D4A channel.